Hello, this is the board I designed to crash my YouTube viewing statistics. Okay, so I use it to make the small remote controlled robot. In this video I will show you more about the board. This video is sponsored by PCBWay. After designing the board, I used the QuickTurn PCB option to upload the Gerber files. That option detects the board dimensions and makes it easy to order the board. The first PCB costs only $5 excluding shipment. After adding the board to my cart, the board got audited. Once the board was approved, I proceeded to checkout to specify my shipment option and my payment method. After payment, the order is taken into production and I could use the PCBWay website to track the production progress. After receiving the board, I unpacked it. I also received this pen and these stickers. The stencils are packaged in hardboard. As you can see, things are well packed and the board itself is of excellent quality. Before stenciling, I first cover the holes where I don't want any solder paste to appear. To fixate the board, I use some of the other boards. Here, snip off a few of the other boards. And then I use some painter's tape to fixate them on the hardboard. The painter's tape keeps it all in one place and makes it easier to apply the stencil paste. After doing that, I position the stencil at the right place and carefully stick some more painting tape so that it doesn't move. Then it's time to open the package, and unfortunately I didn't really take care of my solder paste. As you can see here, it's kind of rock solid, and despite that I used a metal thing to apply the paste. I kind of push it through the holes, and as I work my way to covering all the holes, I try not to make too much of a mess. So takes a bit of time, and I probably added a bit too much solder paste. So at the end I used this nicely supplied cart to remove any excess paste, and hopefully that didn't leave too much paste beneath the metal sheet. The remainder of the paste, even though it's not in the best condition, I still would like to reuse, so I put it back into the package. And well, my other stock of solder paste I have put in the fridge. So let's remove the painter's tape and see what the result is. I'll put it a bit more close so you can see too. And as you can see here, most of the pads have proper amounts of paste, but the small chips, the PCA chip, has a bit too much. Nevertheless, I am going to place all the components. So I did not remove any excess paste, I just kept it there and decided to fix my problems later. And here I kind of throw the chip onto the board. As you can imagine, it takes a bit more time in real life to position every chip at the right place. I usually give it a bit of a tap, and after placing the chips I continue with the smaller components. These are the transistors, diode and the capacitors. There are some more capacitors over here, and basically every chip as a capacitor to work as a energy reserve. I will condense the video a bit so that you don't have to see all the wiggling around. I also added some of these capacitors next to every connection for servos and PWM outputs. And after placing all the different capacitors, I continue to do the resistors. And as you could see, they kind of jumped out. Most of these resistors are pull-up resistors. There are 10K resistors that are placed at the I2C address lines and as pull-up for the I2C data input. Then there's a whole series of resistors next to the PWM output. Those resistors are used so that you can add LEDs directly onto the board. So they're current limiting resistors to allow for direct LED connections. After positioning all the components, I continue with the hot air gun. I will show you only a few of the highlights. Here you can see how the different resistors are soldered, and if I'm moving closely, here you can see the magic of the soldering paste working. This is one of the densest chips, and as you can see, there are only a few short outs, which I will resolve later using my soldering iron. I try to use a number of methods. I first try to pull the excess solder away. If that doesn't work, you can use some solder flux and the ribbon, the copper mesh ribbon. And if that doesn't work, there's the solder suction device that you can use to suck the excess solder away. Well, eventually I did manage to have kind of every leg individually soldered. Well, it may not be the nicest soldering job, but it works. I think at least there are no shorts on the board. So the next step is to solder the header pins for the D1 Mini. And these are just plain female headers. So on the top of the board, I also want to solder two RGB LEDs. I just used the soldering iron to mount these SMD RGBs. And these RGB LEDs are connected to the TM1637. As you can see here, well, the first catch works, which means that the TM1637 works. And now it's time then to add some other components. The first component I add here is the buzzer. The buzzer is connected to the D1 Mini using a transistor, which can amplify the current so that it doesn't overload the output pin of the D1 Mini. And after trimming the wire, it's time to give that a test. So let's see, I reconnect the D1 Mini and switch on the power supply. As you can see, it first shows the LEDs that are being switched off. And then you can hear a small blurb of sound, which indicates that the buzzer also works.
Here you can hear tick. So that's working.
Great. So next item I want to connect is this 5-way button. It's a very small button, and I did make a mistake on my design. The button is oriented straight, where it is actually a diagonal layout, so it should be in a diagonal fashion. But nevertheless, I continue to also solder the display and use the side cutter to cut all the pins a bit shorter so that I don't step myself or make any shorts. So let's test it. As you can see, it displays some text, and by pushing the buttons, you can see the different button codes as well as the handling of the buttons. There's a difference between single clicks and double clicks. And I used an extension of my library to make this all work. You can find my library in my GitHub account, and the buttons do support single clicks and presses, and also double clicks. So next item to solder is the LDR, which is a light sensitive resistor, light dependent resistor, and also two onboard buttons. These are connected to the pins that are also used for the programming mode, and after soldering some more headers to the PWM ports on the chip, I can test to see if the PCA chip has been soldered properly. So let's again connect the D1 mini, and I also made a small board with some individual LEDs. And using the PCA chip, they are using PWM to make them slowly appear. As you can see here, that chip also works. As a final test of the board, I combined some code to make this remote control featuring a self-hosted virtual joystick on a web server and WebSockets for fast communication. You can find links to the various components in the description. Well, I hope you liked this video. If you want to see more of this robot or the techniques I used, you can give your feedback in the comment section. You can subscribe to be notified of future videos. Bye bye.